Hello everyone and thanks Vishal. My name is Yash and I am a AI Sensrad lab member. Today we will be training sigmoid neurons from scratch. So generally for classification, we all know that we just simply import sklearn's logistic regression and we do our classification. But do you know that if you train the same sigmoid neurons, the same loss function with logistic regression uses, you can actually gain a loss accuracy of about 5%. And that is a lot of accuracy. So that is why today we'll be learning how to train these from scratch without using logistic regression, and then we'll compare them. So these are the topics we'll be going through today. Firstly, what is the need of a sigmoid neuron and how did they evolve? Second, what is the impacts of weights and biases on the sigmoid function? Third, what is gradient descent? And more importantly, what are 3D loss plots? And we'll visualize them. Fourth, what is the math behind the sigmoid neurons? Fifth, there are two main loss functions used in this, and those are mean squared errors and cross entropy losses. And we'll be comparing these two to see which performs better. Sixth, what we'll compare the sklearn regression versus sigmoid neurons and see the accuracy of both of them. And last, which would be interesting for the deep learning folks, is how is sigmoid neurons used in neural networks and what are the future uses of sigmoid neurons ahead of machine learning? So let's begin. So as you see in this slide, there are two business cases. The first one is a 1D business case. If you could see my pointer, this shows the income with respect to buyers and non-buyers of a car. So the green points are represented as buyers, whereas the red ones are represented as non-buyers. Now, if you notice that this is a classification case, and you could simply divide them with a line to separate the buyers from the non-buyers. And the same is with the second case, which is in the bottom plot here. This is again a classification case showing buyers versus non-buyers, and the green points represent buyers, red ones represent non-buyers. Again, if you notice one thing, the people who tend to have lower salaries also buy a car when the number of children in the family are higher. This is mainly due to the need of a vehicle in the family. So if you notice, people with, let's say, 40,000 income also and a family size of 5 will buy a car, whereas people with 40,000 income and family size of 0 or number of children in the family 0 will not buy a car. This is mainly because the need of a vehicle in the family is higher. And again, this can be simply separated with a line drawn in between these two, and this is perfectly correct. But this was the initial model, which this was initially used by perceptron models, and they simply just did buyers versus non-buyers or true versus false. And there were a lot of limitations to this. Some of them were, first of all, a perceptron simply drew a line, so it could never do regression. And that is one drawback of a perceptron due to which sigmoids came into picture. Another major need of a sigmoid was, let's say you have points A, B, and C in the buyer's case over here. Now you notice one thing, that B is mostly going to buy a car as per our prediction, because the salary of B is high, that is around 65,000, whereas the number of children in his family are also high, and so he needs a car and he can afford it as well. So the chances of him buying a car will be high. Whereas with A and C, A has a lower salary but has a high need, and C has a high salary but a low need. So both A and C, due to some constraints, they might not buy a car as much as B going to be buying a car. And that is the reason why sigmoids distributed this data into separate categories. Another problem with perceptron was that if the data is not exactly linearly separable, that is, if you cannot just simply draw a line, then the perceptron model simply failed because it distributed the data on a line. And if the data is a little curved, then you would not be able to separate it. And this is what made sigmoids so popular, because it separated data based on some categories. So as you can see in the lower plot over here, each category depicts a probability. So you could see it ranges from 0.0 to 1.0 with all the numbers in the middle. Now, if you analyze B, we know that the chances of B buying a car are 100%, and we know that B will buy a car. So let's say if we had to advertise to a customer, or if we were the sellers and we had to see who should we pay more attention to, logically you would be paying more attention to A or C, because the chances of them buying a car are only 70%. So if you give them more attention, you give them more, like, let's say, discounts or some other schemes, then probably they could buy a car faster than what they would have bought, let's say, maybe 5 months later or 7 months later. They could maybe buy it today also. Another way to look at it is, imagine this 0.5 section, 0.5 region, where there are some people who have bought a car, whereas some people who have not bought a car. So these people are the people with the dilemma that yes or no, and again, buyers or non-buyers. So you see that the people with higher salary generally tend to buy a car, whereas people with lower salary generally tend to not buy a car, even in this 0.5 region. So if you have this data segmented, like in this case, you know that people of this 0.5 region who are in the red area can be converted to a green region, that they can be converted to a buyer if we give them maybe EMI schemes or maybe give them discounts on a car. So if you segment this data like this, then it is a better way to analyze your data and do the same classification only, but in a better manner. Another way you could notice it is if you look at your Google Assistant itself. In today's age, Google Assistant also always gives you a probability. Like you go and ask the Google Assistant to tell you the weather of the day. It will always tell you that there are chances that it'll rain around 70% or 80% chances it will rain. It will never simply just tell it is going to rain or it is not going to rain. And that is the reason why this came into being, that you always need a probability over a simple threshold. So I hope you have understood the need of why you need probabilities and segmentation like this, and it's simply not a threshold. So now let's see how does sigmoid neuron actually work and the internal behind the sigmoid neurons. So you see, this is a sigmoid function written on the top. It might look a little complicated, but I'll explain it to you. It is 1 over 1 plus e power minus wx plus b. Now the w and b are the weights and biases described by us, so we can change it as we want. And x is the input data given to us, so that is not in our control. It will be according to the data given and provided to us, and we need to train our weights and bias accordingly. So you notice one thing. Initially, when we start our model, if we start weights and bias with a high, very high value, what happens is, oh, sorry, if we started with a zero value, and that is generally what we will be doing. So when we initialize it with zero, you notice that the sigmoid function gives a probability of exactly half. How is that so? It gives you a 1 over 1 plus e power wx plus 0. Now you know that 0x and 0 will totally become 0, and it becomes 1 plus e power 0. E power 0 is equal to 1, and so it becomes 1 by 2. So I hope you're clear with, when you initialize it with 0, always the predicted probability is always 1 by 2 in this case. Now let's say you initialize w and b with a very negative value, a very high negative value, that is, let's say, minus 500 each. So now how will this neuron perform in that case? It will go as 1 by 1 over 1 plus e power minus 500x minus 500. I hope I'm clear till this point. I'm just simply substituting the values. So now what happens here is, when we take the, let's take a random value of x, let's say around 1, you notice that this becomes e power minus of minus 1000, e power minus of minus 1000, and thus it becomes e power 1000 is equal to around infinity. Why I'm taking infinity? Because it is a very, very large number here. We can't define it, and so it becomes 1 by infinity, that is 0. So a very negative value will give out to be a probability of 0. Whereas if you take w and b to be a very high number, you notice one thing, that 1 over 1 plus e power minus 500x plus 500, it becomes 1 over 1 plus e power minus 1000. Now e power 1000 is the same as 1 by infinity, or let's say 0, and that is why you get a probability of 1. So what I wanted to show you on this slide is, whatever you range the values, the probability is always going to lie between 0 and 1, half in the exact center, and the probability will never exceed 0 or 1, and that is how this sigmoid function is designed to always give a probability between 0 and 1 only. Now let's see a few further ahead things. How does weight and bias actually affect the curve of the sigmoid? And for that, I think it would be better to show you on Colab. So let's move directly to the Colab notebook, where I would be plotting a few functions. So yeah, all these you would have seen. It's just the simple plotting of one-dimensional data, which I had already shown it to you in the slides. And yeah, you see, this is how the sigmoid is divided. Now let's see. So you see one thing, that if you put e, this 2.71 is the value of e, and when you put it e power minus 1000, it's simply a value of 0, and that is why 1 by e power 1000 becomes a value of 0, and the predicted is 1 is 1, Whereas when you have a very high value, if I put it above 700, Colab gives me a number error. It's too large to calculate. So anyway, you see that the value is always equal to zero or infinity, which is a very large number. E power 304 is 304 zeros, which is a very large number. Anyway, let's see how does the function affect the weights of, how does the value of W and B affect the function. So now you see this f of x is the sigmoid function, which returns 1 by 1 plus e power minus wx plus b. So let's see how does it say. So now I take the value of w and b to be 0 initially. So I initialize it with 0. Let's see how does it plot over. And for each value of x ranging from minus 10 to positive 10, the value predicted is always 0.5. So there is no change in the value for whatever value of x. Let's see how does increasing the value of w change the curve in this case. So you see there's a slight amount of slope which has come, and now you can see that for different values of x, you can see that the predicted values of y or the predicted probabilities at each x would change over. And this is how the values of w can actually affect your curve. So if you see at 0.5, you notice that this curve has become even more steep at the center, and at the ends, it's always predicting a probability of 0 or 1 in this case. If you see my pointer, if you follow it over here, it is 1, and in the left side, it is 0. Now let's further increase the value of W, and let's see how does it go about. So you see that by putting a value of 1, you can have this type of curve, which will always predict a value between 0 and 1, but at the center, the slope is high, and at the ends, it tends to flatten out. So this was the value of W for this curve e power minus WX plus B. Now let's visualize B. And for visualizing B, I think it's better I introduce some grids into the plot to explain it. So yeah, you could see that the blue dot is the center of the sigmoid. Now what is the center of the sigmoid? It is the point at which the sigmoid predicts a probability of 0.5. And that is why this line over here showing you that this is a value of 0.5 at the leftmost end. You can see it's at 0.5. And this straight line shows you at which point at on the x-axis is this blue dot. So right now it is at 0 for a value of b equal to 0. Let's change the value of b equal to, let's say, 2. And we notice that this point has shifted behind the 0 for about some units, let's say 1.5 or 2 units. Again, we don't know what yet. Let's further reduce it and put it to 5. And you notice that this point, this dot, had shifted behind the origin by 5 units right now. So you see that by changing the values of W and B, you can fit any possible configuration in this. Now, another question you would be asking is, what if you wanted a reverse plot, or what if you want, if you put the values of W and B to a negative value? Let's say I put the value of W to be minus 1 and B to be 0. So what happens in that case? So you see that the plot totally reverses its direction. Initially, this positive 1 prediction was towards the right of the center of the sigmoid, whereas now it has become towards the left. So the negative values are predicted as 1 probability, and the positive values are predicted as a 0 probability. So you notice that by changing the W and B values, you can actually configure and make any possible plot in your any possible sigmoid according to the condition you require. So now, how does this relate to our example, which you had seen the one-dimensional or two-dimensional data? Let's visualize that right now. So you know that this was our initial one-dimensional data. A small change, what I have done is the points were initially only one-dimensional, that was on this point. Now I've lightened this and pushed it up and the red points down. Reason, because these are all true bias and the probability should be 1. These are all non-bias or false and the probability should be 0, and there is no other change in this. Let's see how does the sigmoid do. So this was the segmentation done by the sigmoid, and let's plot the curve for this. So you see that this blue line over here shows the sigmoid curve. So you see that if we have a very high weights value, like let's say 100 over here, you can see that this can be very close to a perceptron type line. Now, the perceptron was not wrong in its classification, it just had limitations. But for a classification model, the perceptron always works correct, it's not wrong. So you see that this can perform like a perceptron if the weights values are high. So you see that for now, all the greens are classified as 1, all the reds are classified as 0, and this is perfectly correct. Now let's see if you manipulate the values of W and change the graph. Let's see what happened. So now in this, if you see, the values of W were reduced a little. I've put it to 10 right now, and you see that the points after this 0.5, 0.25 value are all classified as 1. All below 0.3 value are classified as 0, and the remaining are in the decision zone. That is, we had seen the confusion 0.5 zone, right? So all the other points are now in that zone where you could do whatever extra strategy you want to those, and you could customize it as you want. So this is how changing the W and B values for a one-dimensional data can give you a probability to suit your own curve as you liked. I hope you are catching up with this right now. This is just a one-dimensional plot. Let's now see what happens in the two-dimensional world. Yeah, this was the one-dimensional plot. Let's go with ex of the two-dimensional world. This was the 2D data which the sigmoid had classified into regions. Let's see how does that actually perform in a three-dimensional world. So you notice one thing, that this was the perceptron line, the black color line, sorry, the black color line which separated the bias from the non-bias. Now this had limitations, but this was not wrong. And the same can be done with the sigmoid as well. So for a perfect classification which we want to do, you notice that the green shaded area is the predicted probability of the sigmoid, and right now for all the green points it is predicting true, for all the red points it is predicting false, and the yellow line is the same as this perceptron line which is separating the bias from the non-bias, and it is giving this line in the middle which is separating 1 from 0. So I hope you get that a sigmoid can perform perfectly like a perceptron and do classification as well. Now let's view it in this angle and let's see. So you notice one thing, that all the green points, if they are la stacked in the upper area with a probability of 1, and all the red points which are stacked in the lower area with a probability of 0. You notice that the sigmoid curve plotted for this will totally be the same shape as this sigmoid plotted over here for the one-dimensional data. The shape of the sigmoid is the same. The values of W and B can just change the steepness of the slope in the middle. So that is why we can say that the nature of the sigmoid or the S-shaped curve will always be same for any number of dimensional data you have. So if you have a 4D or a five-dimensional data, let's say you have five features in your input vector, you will have the same S-shaped curve. There will be no change in that. The only difference will be that you cannot visualize it. In a 2D, you can easily visualize it. So let's see how does this actually look in 3D. So you can see that this has a staircase-like function where this is at all 1, this is at all 0, and this is the region at which we can actually have a smooth transition in the curve. So this is a 3D looking data, and this is how a sigmoid would perform for you this thing. So now I think it would be better that we take a small break and look at the questions which people would have posted, if any.
None so far.
None so far. So I hope everyone is able to catch up with me, right? No one has lost track of my pace right now.
So I would say just slightly go slow. You are pretty fast, so you may be facing a lot of questions towards the end, I am feeling.
Oh, okay, sure, Vishal. I'll try to do that. I'll go a little slower in my content.
Yeah, go ahead.
But if anyone has any questions, it would be better you ask something related to this right now, because later you might even lose those questions from your mind. So it would be better you post it up right now. I would be happy to clear it.
So, what is the activation function of a perceptron?
For the perceptron, it's not, there is no activation function, it's just a linear regression type thing. The difference between a perceptron and linear regression is linear regression does regression, so it will give you the value, whereas perceptron draws a line, but it will simply just separate the data into two parts. So it is not giving you a value, it is giving you the regions for the data. So like in this case, this perceptron line, this black color line, divided this whole data into two regions. It's not the value it's returning, it is giving you the regions for the prediction. So anything below this black line will be a false, anything above this black line will be like the true or the bias case, you could say.
Sure. Any
Vishal,
other
is there?
questions, audience? Not getting any others, you can go ahead.
So, okay, I think it would be better we could proceed with it. We'll see if any question person will cater to them later. So now let's see what are contour plots. So before I go into contour plots, I wanted to show you this is a 3D plot, but if you just change the direction of this, which we had seen initially itself, you could see that this was also a type of a 2D plot where the red green points are represented as true, the red points are represented as false and non-biased, and the shaded region is the predicted probability by the sigmoid at each area. So now when we plot a contour plot, it is the same thing. It is just a 2D representation of the 3D plot. Now the reason why we are doing this is every time we can't be plotting a 3D plot because it is tough to show you and tough to visualize it also every time. So that is why we would prefer to shift to a 2D plot. Now notice this plot and this plot are the exact same things. There is no difference between both these plots. You just need to visualize this contour plot as a 3D plot by thinking that the green area is the predicted probability of 1, the red area is the predicted probability of 0, and the yellow region over here is the confusion or decision boundary, that is like the, let's say, the 0.5 values which you had. Now, if you see, if you change the values of W and B in this case, you would simply just get a thicker decision area, that is, the slope at this point is little less steep as compared to the slope at that point. So that is how you could imagine contour plots. So in this, the green perfectly one predicted region will be smaller, whereas in the previous example, you had seen that the yellow was thin and the greens were thicker. So the area of one prediction would be less in this and more in that. But this is the same plot as done above over here. Only difference is this is a 2D plot. So let's move ahead with this. And how does this actually relate to our example above?
So yes, two questions here.
Oh yeah, sure.
So what's the difference between ReLU and sigmoid? Is that the only range?
Not exactly. ReLU function gives you a mod x value after zero. So in sigmoid, if you notice, in sigmoid, if you see this plot, for above zero, you have a curved up function over here, and changing the W and B values, you can change the curve of this to suit you as you want it. But ReLU has a zero value before zero, so all of these will simply be nullified. And above zero, they have a mod x value. The slope or the line would be a little like mod x, that is the diagonal line over there. So ReLU and sigmoid are totally different functions. Sigmoid is a non-linear function which has a complex formula, whereas ReLU is simply just a line drawn. And one more point I would like to say is tan h and sigmoid would be pretty close. Tan h is a S-shaped curve, same as sigmoid, and it would also lie in the range of -1 to +1. So I hope it's clear for the question, right?
Okay, another question is there.
I'm not able to exactly see that.
Another question is, so there is no non-linearity for a perceptron.
No, for a perceptron, there's no non-linearity. It's just a simple line which it draws to separate the data. There is no non-linearity.
Okay.
So I hope I'm clear with the questions, right?
You can go ahead if people want to know more, they will ask.
Okay, sure. So yeah, now let's imagine this loss plot which we had. This is not related to our data which I was doing. I would want to show you a contour plot of this to explain contour plots in detail. So let's say you had this loss plot which shows for each B value and each W value, you have a corresponding loss for a set given data. So don't try to think a lot about it. I just wanted to explain contour plots with this example. So how would this look for a contour version is this. So let's imagine this in a better dimension to explain this. So if you notice, the same 3D plot looking from it from the top looks like this, where this is a blue region, this is a light blue, dark green, and then yellow region. And that's the same thing shown over here. There is a dark blue region here, then slightly lightens up to become a greenish region, then a light green, and then becomes yellow. So these two plots are the same. And after this, we would mostly be plotting contour plots itself, not 3D plots, because it is tough to plot 3D plots and contour plots are easier to plot and understand. So let's move ahead with gradient descent. Now, all of you might have just simply used logistic regression or linear regression in your day-to-day life, but have you actually wondered how does it internally reduce or how does it internally update the values of W and B? And now let's understand they use simple function and simple gradient descents to do that. So what is gradient descent? It is the value or it is the gradient calculated at each point and then updated to the values of weights and bias. And this is how the weights and bias reach the global minima or the least loss value. So now it's better to actually visualize this in a plotting sense and understand it. So let's go ahead and do that. So let's say I initialize W and B values to a value of 2 and 4 with this data given over here. So you notice that for when I run my model for 200 EPOs, it starts with a loss, starts updating itself at each EPO. Let's say I don't know what is the value I update, and then it comes down to a value of 0.06, that is the global minima which it has reached. So now let's visualize this and plot how does this look. So you see this plot. This shows the change of weights and bias over each EPO, where the x-axis represents the EPO and y-axis represents the value of them. So notice that the red one, which is showing the loss, starts with a value of 1, goes and slowly reduces for each EPO, and suddenly drops down to a value of 0.06, which was the least, and then stays constant. So at around the 75th EPO, you can see that the model has learned itself and reached the global minima, and after that, there is no learning. So you can see that the weight values, which are shown in blue over here, which started at a value of 2.1, slowly update themselves to reach a value of, let's say, 0.02 or something. And that is how they see that at 0.02, I can get a least loss in the thing, or I have reached the global minima at 0.02. And same with the bias. The bias start at a value of 4. They keep changing themselves over some number of EPOs, go down to a value of, let's say, minus 0.5, and settle over there because they see that the loss is the least over here. So these are the optimal values of W and B, which we have achieved at around the 75th or 80th EPO. But now let's see how do they actually do it. Let's visualize this. So you see that the W and B values are at the end where 0.02 and minus 0.42 from starting from 2.1 and 4.0. So you have seen that there has been some change. Let's visualize this. So you can see, this is the 3D plot for the loss initially. So you can see that the W and B values range from 6 to minus 8 and minus 8 to 6 again. And for each value of W and B, for this corresponding given data, this data which we had seen initially, these two values for a given X and then corresponding value of Y, we have some loss at each W and B. And now it is our duty to find the most optimal value of W and B, and we know that it is at this, and it is at around 0.02 and minus 0.42, which corresponds to this blue region in this 3D plot. So how to understand this 3D plot? It is the plot of the loss with respect to W and B. And notice that this dark blue region over here, it has the least loss, or it is the global minima of this whole function or the whole B and W values. So if we start at values at, let's say, this corner at my pointer, if you notice my pointer, if you start at this end, our duty is to bring and update the values of W and B in such a way that they move and come to the global minima, that is the least loss point, and that is this valley down here. If you notice, if we start at this corner, you will slowly start moving in this direction and move to the global minima, that is this point here. And that is what our models, or let's say linear regression, logistic regression, or any other model does. It takes the W and B values starting at any point and updates itself to move towards the global minima, and that is this blue region. So let's see how does it look in 2D. So this is the corresponding contour plot of this 3D region. Now we had seen simple contour plots earlier, but this is a complicated one. How do you understand this? Is that all the red regions over here are the high losses and the blue is the global minima. The lines over here are a little curved, so you'll have to remember the colors for each value of W and B, and the white is a very 0 point, let's say the values of 0.5 in this area. So this is a stretch of white area, and this is a mountain like valley like thing, a loss over here. So let's see how are they updated over each thing. So this is a small video which I have made. So you could see that for the first 10 epochs it moves this way, and each epoch it is moving towards the global minima. So you can see that it is moving, it is updating its values always towards the direction of the global minima, and that is how it updates its values. So the W and B value can be updated starting with anything. They will always be updated in the direction of the global minima, and this is what we see in this plot over here. So I hope this is clear that how these are done. Let's see this in three dimensional as well. How does this happen in three dimensional, and then we will have a better understanding. So this was the initial three dimensional plot which we had earlier, which I had explained. And now if you see the weights, change in weights and bias values over here, you can see that at each epoch they are moving towards the global minima. So you can see this is the contour plot which was drawn earlier, and the 3D version looks like this. So I hope you're getting the idea of how the weights and bias values are updated over each epoch and how they reach the global minima. So right now it might be a good time to let's stop and see some questions asked by people.
I've sent you one question.
How it's selected in deeply connected hidden layers? You mean how are the W and B values selected? Vishal, do you mean to
no,
say
so
how
I will I will let the gentleman clarify that.
Okay, sure. Vishal, is my speed okay right now? Am I still fast or is it fine right now?
No, that's fine.
Okay. Question.
So either you can clarify the question who asked for this, how it's selected in deeply connected hidden layers, or if there are any other questions, please ask.
I think it would be better we'll wait for his question fully. Till then I would move along with my explanation. We could clarify these towards the end also, that would be better maybe.
Sure.
Okay, so now we know that the weights and bias values are updated at each point. But let's now see what are the weights and bias updated at each point, and that is given by the gradients at each point. Now this is the place where we look into the maths of how does this whole thing work. Now you will have to go through the maths of this to actually achieve such a high accuracy, because without going through such details of the working, you can't actually just boost the accuracy. So we will have to go through this. So let's try understanding how does each value of W and B update over each EPO. So now you know that there are two main types of losses: mean squared error loss and cross entropy loss. What are they? So the mean squared error is indirectly the error, that is yi minus yi hat. Yi hat is the prediction done by the sigmoid. So let's say you have an x or the input vector x, you will pass it over the sigmoid, so you will have the formula of 1 by the 1 plus e power minus wx plus b. That value will give a probability of, let's say, between 0 and 1. Now you'll subtract y minus yi hat. Now y is the true value, let's say 0 or 1 or any regression value. You will square that over and take the average of that, and that is what is called the mean squared error, the mean of the square of the errors at each point. And now there is another loss, that is the cross entropy loss, that tells you it is the difference between the entropies of the true value versus the predicted value, or the true class versus the predicted class. So the true class over here is yi log yi hat. The true class is yi log yi, and the predicted class is yi log yi hat. And the difference between these, and then taken an average, is the cross entropy loss. Now this might look a little confusing. This formula over here is a little this thing, but it's simply when you substitute the values of yi at each point, you will notice that it simply boils down to a value of minus log base 2 yi hat of the corresponding class. Now in sigmoids, there is only one class, that is the true class or the false class. But when you have, let's say, a 6-class or 7-class classification in neural networks, then the cross entropy loss corresponds to the class with which the current entry is. So let's say if you have to predict for the third class, you will simply calculate the log loss for the third class, and you won't consider the log values for the other class. So that is how the values of, that is how the cross entropy loss and mean squared loss for loss functions are. So now you'll have to derive these with respect to the values of W and B to get a better this thing. And I think there's a question which has come up. Sigmoid and Reloid are selected in hidden layers. How are they selected? There is no fixed way to select sigmoid or ReLU or anything. You can do it yourself or you can randomly do them. There is no fixed way to do them in this. For now, let's just concentrate on a more basic understanding of logistic regression or maybe the sigmoid curves. We'll get to neural networks after the explanation of logistic regression. So we'll address these questions towards the end of this webinar where we'll address the neural network part. Please explain the white region. The white region you want to know for the plots which we had above over here.
Yes.
Vishal?
Yes.
Vishal? Okay, yeah. So these regions which you wanted to know about the white regions are the regions which are predicted as a probability of 0.5. So this area was the red region which had, let's say, a loss of let's say 0.7, 0.8, or even 1. The blue region might be a loss of 0.2, 0.1 or something, and the white region is a loss of 0.5. So the white region is just a color coding of the transition between the red and blue. There is no other significance. So all the colors here are just the color codings representing a value. So understand that the blue values over here are the lower loss values, whereas the red values over here are the higher loss values. That's it. There is no other complication to this point here. I hope I'm clear, Vishal.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead.
Okay, so let's go ahead. So now let's look at the math behind this. How are the derivative gradients calculated over each point? So now we know that the loss at the mean squared error or the loss for each point is y minus y hat whole squared. Now this is not taken a mean because it is a single point value, and the weights are updated by w is equal to w minus learning rate times this delta w, which is given by the gradient of this. Same with b. B is given by the derivative of loss with respect to b values, and which is given by this. I hope I'm clear till here. So let's move ahead. So now what is the gradient of w? It is calculated as derivative of loss with respect to derivative of w. That is equal to half of derivative of y minus y hat whole squared by derivative of w. Now let's take y minus y hat as equal to m. Now this is a little complicated math, but you'll have to go through this to understand how does our model actually improve its accuracy. So let's take y minus y hat as equal to m. So what will and applying the chain rule at this point, we'll simply get half of derivative of m squared with respect to m into derivative of m with respect to w. This is simply the chain rule where I'm substituting this value as m and applying the chain rule in this case. Simple by standard math. So it becomes half of 2m. Now m squared derivatives gives you 2m into dm by dw. And substituting the value of m over here, you will simply get y minus y hat into dm by dw. So now our duty is to calculate what this dm by dw value is. And let's see, dm by dw is given as d of y minus y hat with respect to w. Now this is simple subtraction over here, so you simply separate it. And now we know that y has no relation with w over here. So that is why we can simply cancel out y. Y is the input vector or the input value given to us. That might be 0 or 1 or any regression value. And we know that this is no relation with w, and so that is why they'll get cancelled out. So dm by dw simply boils down to minus of d y hat with respect to w. I hope I'm clear till here. It's not very confusing till here at least. So let's further proceed. Now y hat is the sigmoid function which is given by the formula of 1 by 1 plus e power minus wx plus b, w and b being vectors over here. So now you know that this can be further substituted. So let's put the denominator over here, 1 plus e power minus wx plus b as equal to t. So when we substitute this with t and apply the chain rule, you get derivative of 1 by t with respect to t into derivative of t with respect to w. So now you notice the derivative of 1 by t would be minus 1 by t squared. Simple by standard math again. And into dt by dw. So now calculate and substitute this value of t. We will simply push this value here and notice that it becomes 1 by 1 plus e power minus wx plus b whole squared. I'm not doing any changes here, just simply substituting the value here into dt by dw. Now dt by dw we must calculate. That is the same as 1 plus e power minus wx plus b with respect to w. And now you notice that this is an addition, so you can again split it. and you can cancel the one out here because it's a constant with respect to w. So it gives out to derivative of e power minus wx plus b with respect to w. Again, we'll do some substitution in this and we'll put wx plus b as equal to r. So now what happens is you get dt by dw is equal to derivative of e power minus r into derivative of r into derivative of r with respect to w. So now e power minus r derivative would be minus e power minus r into d of wx plus b with respect to w. Now again, you know that derivative, this is an addition, so you will simply split this up and you'll cancel b over here because it has no relation with w. And when you simplify this equation up, you'll get minus e power minus wx plus b, which is r. The r value I've taken from here and I've put it into this. So there is e power minus wx plus b into d wx with respect to w. And this goes to simply a vector x. So this long calculation which we were doing, now we just simply need to back substitute all these values and we derive the loss with respect to w in this case. So you notice that derivative of y hat with respect to w was minus 1 by t squared or minus 1 by this thing squared into dt by dw. And we have the value of dt by dw as minus e power minus wx plus b into x. So simply substitute this back there and you'll get the value of dy by dw as this into this dt by dw. Now further going ahead, dm by dw was minus derivative of y hat with respect to w. Now if you see that dm by dw simply negate this value in this dy by dw, and you'll see that there's a negative sign over here. If you can see my pointer over here, there's a negative sign at this e thing, and they will just get cancelled out with the outside negative value. So this simply boils down to this initially dy by dw without the negative sign over here. And now going to the loss with respect to w, you see that the loss with respect to w was y minus y hat into dm by dw. And now we have the value of dm by dw from here. So simply put the value of this into this equation and you would get the derivative of the loss. That is y minus y hat into 1 by 1 plus e power minus wx plus b whole squared into e power minus wx plus b into x. Now I know this might look very confusing and this is a very complicated formula also. But if you do a simple set of maths, take your pen and paper and start cutting out factors over here, you would notice that this long, these two middle terms which have the e power, they will simply just boil down to a value of y hat into 1 minus y hat. And so the derivative of loss with respect to w would be y hat minus y hat into 1 minus y hat into x. Now this, all these long calculations which we have done over here, just simply come down and close to a value of this simple one single line equation, which is easy to actually calculate because we will anyway be having this y hat as the sigmoid function, and that is not a great thing. Now this same thing can be applied with b. Don't worry, the b looks as long as above, but it's not actually that long. Everything initially is the same except the point where, notice this, in this dt by dw we had derivative of wx plus b with respect to w, where b was a constant. So in this case, when we are deriving it with respect to b, w and x become constants, and so wx will get cancelled with respect to b. And so the whole function in this case will become dv by dv will become 1, so there will not be any x value here. So you notice in the earlier example, dt by dw had a x value in the end multiplied to some value over here. But in this b value, there will not be any x multiplied over here. Dt by dv will simply be minus e power minus wx plus b. Same with all the other things, the calculations are the same without an x value here. And you notice in the last also, the loss with respect to b will have y hat minus y hat into 1 minus y hat without the value x. Now I know this might sound a little complicated and the math is a little long, it's a little tricky over here. So I know there are many doubts which people have, and I will go through this math once more towards the end, clearing all the doubts. I am falling a little short of time, and so I think it would be better I start moving ahead with this. But don't worry, I'll clear all your doubts towards the end, where all the doubts pile up together, and I would be happily clearing all these doubts towards the end. So let's move ahead and see how does gradient descent work. So now we have the calculated gradient values for each point over here. We see that the values are got by these formulae. And now simply we need to apply these to get a loss of each point. So now you notice, let's plot some functions and see. This was the initial plot which we had for a two-dimensional data. You can see that this is normalized in these two directions. I have taken it in the form of a data frame and now converted it to a NumPy array because it's easy to calculate NumPy vectors. This is the same sigmoid function in two dimensional. And these are the gradient values or the gradient functions. Might be a good time to explain these. So this is gradient of weights with on the MSE loss. So what that does, it simply returns the calculated value we had done y hat into y hat minus y into y hat into 1 minus y hat into x. And same with b without the x. Now the cross entropy loss, which I did not clear, it's actually easy to do the calculations on the math part, but I don't have time to go through the math right now. So let's go ahead with this. The cross entropy loss is simply a formula of y hat into x if the value of y is 0. And if the value of y is 1, it returns a value of y hat minus 1 into x. And same with the gradient b part, which does not return a value of x in the end. And it simply just returns y hat and y hat minus 1. Vishal, am I going a little very fast for people over here?
I suggest you can move on. If people have queries, they will ask.
Yeah, the math might be a little confusing for people, so I'll move on. I'll get to that again. I know people would have got confused. I'll get to that again. So let's now visualize this. These two functions calculate MSE gradient. What that does is, let's say you have a set number of EPOs. So for each EPO, for let's take one EPO for example, it initializes the gradient values to zero for both. So gradient, so DW would be zero, DB would be zero. It will go through the data frame once. So let's say you have 1,000 points in your data frame. It will go through all the 1,000 points at once, calculate gradient for each point. So for point one, there would be a gradient, point two, there would be a gradient, and keep summing it up. So gradient will keep adding 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus till 1,000. And that will be updated in the W value. That W is equal to W minus delta gradient of that. So we had seen it initially. So that was just the simple subtraction of the values. This, you know, is got by the formula anyway. So this is done for one EPO, and if you have, let's say, such 1,000 EPOs, it will, the whole process will be repeated 1,000 times. There is no difference. It is just a repetition of the whole process again. And this is how all our loss functions converge. They will take a value. They will keep updating for each EPO the W and B values, and the final W and B is done for the nth EPO. Let's say you have 1,000. So for the 1,000th EPO, that is the last loss which you get. So this is for the MSE value. Let's see for the cross entropy value. Cross entropy will just have a different function, but the process of doing this is the same. For n number of EPOs, it will update n number of times, and that's it. It will update the values of W and B n number of times with a different loss function as compared to MSE. That is it. There is no difference. Let's move ahead with this. So initially I initialize all my values to zero, that is W1, W2 and B values to zero. And let's see how does that look. So now, you know, when there's a value of zero, all the values will be predicted as 0.5. So you can see in this case that yellow shows 0.5 in this plot. And this is how our W and B values of zero give a prediction of 0.5. And plotting the corresponding 3D plot, it looks something like this, where there is only a straight line and it shows that all the values are predicted to 0.5. Now let's compare the cross entropy with mean squared error loss. So you see that after the first EPO, there is not much learning in the plot. So you see all the values are still 0.5, but the moment you give the second EPO, you see that the red region over here has some amount of learning. So this plot is at least able to figure out that this is the red region over here. For the third EPO, you see that there is at least a boundary drawn here. So the green is separated from the red region for the third EPO. And the fourth EPO, let's see, fourth EPO, again, it goes back to a plot of this and it saw that this might be the better way to do it. And the corresponding 3D plot of this looks like this, where there is a slight slope better than the 0.5, which was a straight flat line. So at least the model is learning something right now. So let's see how does it go ahead with more EPOs. So for, let's say the 21st EPO, or the 20th EPO, you can see that there's some amount of learning in this. At least the values or the region which we could afford is between this green edge and the red edge, and our yellow region must fit in that. So you can see that the model right now is at least learning a little bit, and it is simply not sleeping over the EPOs. So for the 35th EPO, you can see that now at least there is some amount of learning. There is some slope which has at least come in this thing. Let's fast forward a little bit to see how it goes about. So you can see that around the 60th EPO, 66th EPO, you can see that there's a small slope which has already been derived over here. The red points at least have started being classified as false over here, fully zero, and one green point is classified as true over here with a probability of 0.1. And the corresponding curve or the S shape looks like this right now. So there is some amount of learning. Let's fast forward a little bit and let's see how does it go over some EPOs. You can see that the region over here is further contradicting with some green values as zero, some red values as one, sorry, green values as one, red values as zero, and this is still going thinner and thinner by each EPO. Further increases, further reduces. So you can see that there's some amount of learning in this. And I think it would be better to actually fast forward this point. So you can see that by some EPOs, it is further reducing. And you see that by the around the 10,000th EPO, it has completely done its learning. So all the green points are fully classified as probability one and red points are classified as a probability of zero. But 10,000 EPOs are not a logical number to feed to your models. So that is why we notice that the mean squared error loss, which we are applying right now, is not the correct loss type which we need to apply. So let's actually change a few things and do. Let's compare it with cross entropy loss. So now, let's see how does cross entropy perform. So you notice for the first EPO, both of these models have no learning. So both of these are equally the same. But the moment you give the second EPO, you see that the cross entropy loss has started doing much better than the mean squared error loss. It has a better decision boundary as compared to the mean squared in the second EPO itself. Now let's go ahead a little bit. Notice that in the third EPO also, there is a much higher learning. In the fourth EPO, the boundaries are starting to decide that this is the total green area and this is the total red area, and now it must reduce itself. So now you see that the mean squared error 3D plot is still between 0.6 and 0.4, whereas the cross entropy loss, you can see it's already predicting a value of 0.8 and 0.2 sometimes. So it is much faster. So now let's move ahead. So yeah, you can see at around the 50th EPO, that the cross entropy loss has become much thinner as compared to the mean squared error loss, and that is why cross entropy is the correct loss function to use for this type of classification model. So for classification, mean squared error is never the correct model to use, and you can compare the two 3D plots as well. In this, you can see that this 3D plot has still a very slopy region, whereas this has started to create the S shape already. So let's start fast forwarding a little bit. You can see that by the 700th EPO, the cross entropy loss has done its classification fully, whereas it took around 10,000 EPOs for mean squared error to do it. And that is the advantage of using cross entropy over mean squared error. And that is one big advantage you can see which loss function to use when. Now I wanted to show one more point. Let the plots run. I would go through them soon. So you notice one thing now, that let's take the 7500 EPO. You see that this is a very good plot right now because it is classifying just one and zero. But if you notice the cross entropy plot, the decision boundary has become very thin, and this is a clear case of overfitting the data. So now you can see that why you should not apply many EPOs to cross entropy. You should always give a limited number of EPOs to the cross entropy loss. And now I hope I'm done with the explanation part, and this is how all our loss functions work. This is the class, which is just a summary of the above, so I'm not going to explain each point in the class. One point I wanted you to notice is, how do you classify? So what we do is, in the fit function, we take x train and y train for a set number of EPOs and learning rate. For take y train, and we'll calculate the number of zeros and ones in that. So now if there are only zeros and ones in the y train data, then the total number would be same as the number of rows in y train, and we could classify them as a classification type problem. And if there is even one value which is lesser than that, then it's a regression type problem. So this is how we do our separation between classification and regression, and we'll apply the corresponding loss functions according to that. So let's move ahead. Just a second. All this is the regression type data set. I'm not going through this because we are falling a little short of time. I would go through the main part, that is classification, and comparing it with logistic regression. You know that our model can do regression as well, so you can run it yourself later. My codes are available on GitHub. You can access my GitHub for the codes if you wish. Notice that we are using the breast cancer data set in the classification type, which have 512 rows and 30 columns. Now let's import the logistic regression, instantiate both classes, fit the same data on both the classes. And predict for both. And now let's check the accuracy. So now you know that logistic regression gives an accuracy of about 89%, whereas our model, when you compare it, it will give an accuracy of literally 94%, which is a 5.3% bump, and that is a big margin. So that is why using and coding a sigmoid neuron from scratch will always give you a better accuracy than using the inbuilt function. And now when we convert, when we compare other parameters, like let's say F1 score, it is already a, let's say, 0.5 increase. Recall is another 0.4 or 0.5 increase. And precision is another 0.6 increase, with precision in my model is about coming to about 1, which is a very, very rare case. So we, as you can see, this is how training our sigmoid neurons from scratch would work. You could train it and get a better accuracy than this. So this is what I would say, that this is what our a model could perform better than this. So I think I'm running short on time. I have one small point, and how is this used ahead in neural networks? So Vishal, could I stretch for another 5 minutes? If that would not be a problem, then I could explain the neural network part also to people. It would be sure. Good for them. Sure. Okay, sure. So I hope everyone is clear with the sigmoid neuron part at least, and how it does its prediction and comparison to logistic regression. So now let's go to the neural network part. So I would want to show one small thing. This is the neural network which we have made, a very small neural network. I know it's not a very deep neural network, but try to understand. So imagine there are three sigmoid neurons in this place. So you have H1 as one sigmoid neuron, H2 as one sigmoid neuron, and H3 as one sigmoid neuron. Notice that in all these three cases, the input data will be almost, sorry, the H1 and H2, which are the first layer sigmoid neurons. Let's say you take this. So you have this sigmoid neuron, which is taking input from X1 and X2 with a set of weights, that is W1 and W3, and with its given bias B1. So I hope you get the idea that this is a straightaway case of sigmoid neuron, which it has some set of weights, bias, and two inputs, X1 and X2. So it is a sigmoid neuron. Now you take the second sigmoid neuron, that is this H2 over here. So this H2 is again a sigmoid neuron which takes the same input as sigmoid neuron 1, X1 and X2, with a weights value of W2 and W4 this time, and a bias value which is independent of the initial. So this is again an independent sigmoid irrespective of the first sigmoid. And now when you combine these two, you see the first sigmoid will have a, let's say, a prediction of, let's say, 0.5. And the second sigmoid gives a prediction of, let's say, 0.7 with the corresponding weight and bias values. And now the third sigmoid over here, this upper sigmoid over here, has its independent weight W5 and W6, has its input as the output of the first layer sigmoid. So in this case, the input of the H3 sigmoid neuron will be 0.5 and 0.7, which is a totally correct input. And it will have its separate bias B3 over here. And this is the magic where it takes place. So you notice I would go through this example in. So let's say you had this type of data in your this thing. This is another collab which I had opened. This is your data over here where you have four classes, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So now you have to classify these. Let's say I separate them into two classes. Now I don't leave it as a four class classification. I do it into two classes where this is one class, where the extremes are green, and this red one is another class which is in the middle. Now you notice one thing, that if you simply apply a sigmoid, it cannot classify these easily because there is no correct clear decision boundary in this. So you see that this area, if a sigmoid classifies in this first area, if you follow my pointer, in the upper area, if the sigmoid does its classification, then all the lower green points will be classified as false, and that we cannot afford to do that. If the sigmoid does a classification on this lower area, all the upper sigmoids will be classified as false, and we can again not afford to do that. And this is the place where stacking sigmoids to form neural networks like this came into a good use. So you can now, let's visualize how that works. So this is a neural network coded from scratch with all its values updated, same loss functions as earlier. You'll have to code the loss with this. You notice that training it over 2000 EPOs, it again has a good loss in the start, but it learns to reduce it in the end. Now let's plot it and see how it looks. So you notice one thing, that this data was initially like this. The H1 neuron, the neuron over here, I'm talking about this. You look at the picture on the right slide. This is the neuron I'm talking about right now. So this neuron, what it does is it sees that, okay, this region would be the best possible classification at the first stage. So it takes its classifier and separates this green area from these red areas. So red is making a mistake on the lower green region. So now what H2 does is, this H2, what I'm talking about is this plotter on this side, this second neuron in the first layer in the picture I've shown. So what H2 does is it sees that H1 is classifying the first area. So H2 will classify the second area in this region. And you can see that it draws its decision boundaries in this region over here. So H2 and H1 now do separate classification. And now the power of a neural network comes when you take H3, like this neuron up over here, which is taking inputs from both H1 and H2. And what H3 does is it takes its input from H1 and H2 and does both sides classification. So now this model, taking two sigmoids, you can see that the upper area is classified as fully green and the lower area is classified as fully green and the center one is classified as fully red. And this is the place where neural network takes advantage of a sigmoid neuron. Just simply stacking our sigmoid neurons, which we used initially, can give you a much more complex boundary formations as compared to a normal neural network. A normal sigmoid neuron. And yeah, this is what I had for my webinar for the day. So I thank you all. This is my contact details. So if any of you wanted to contact me, you could contact me with my email or number and check my code. These are available on my GitHub. So you could go and play around with the values. Now, do you have any questions for me to address? Do you have any doubts or anything?
So thank you, Yash. So I have posted some questions to you. Please check the chat box.
Sure. Just a second. Please explain the why it is used for classification. If not, why also is it right to use? Mean squared error is not the correct point for classification. Well, you can use it, but then the number of EPOs you will have to naturally supply are very, very high. And it is, if you have a loss function like cross entropy available, it is pointless to use mean squared error. Now, I had shown you the comparison in the two.
I suggest you read the question and then answer it so people will know what was asked.
Is mean squared error used for classification? If not, why? Also, is it right to use? So yeah, I would go back to my comparison which I had done a few minutes ago. So you can see that these are the comparison of the plots which I had done. So now notice one thing, that cross entropy always generally tends to perform better than the mean squared error loss. So for even the 20th EPO, you can see cross entropy is higher. At even, let's say, the 400th EPO, the cross entropy loss is much higher than the mean squared error. The reason why this happens is because mean squared error and cross entropy both learn only from the places where they're making errors. Now in mean squared error, the error which it achieves, it further diminishes it. It makes it a smaller value to update the loss and the parameters of W and B. And that is why even if there are, let's say, 30 points of wrong classification over here, whereas there are only, let's say, 5 or 6 wrong points classification in cross entropy does not diminish the error achieved from these 5, 6 points. And that is why it will always, even if it has 5, 6 points left in this decision boundary, it will still have a higher learning than even 30 points left for the mean squared error to learn. And that is why for classification, it is always advised to use cross entropy. But when you use cross entropy, one more point which I wanted to take is, if you use cross entropy for regression, what happens is, because mean squared error diminishes the loss, and in regression, you will generally not have many points classified. Many of them will be lost. So cross entropy blasts the loss in regression. And that is why you'll have a lot of fluctuations in your values. You will never be able to stabilize your loss in cross entropy using cross entropy in a regression model. Whereas if you use mean squared error in regression, there will be only small updates each time you do your regression. And that is why there is at least some amount of stability, let's say after 500 or 1000 EPOs, and you can achieve a stability at least in mean squared error while doing regression. And that is the advantage of using cross entropy. So I hope I have cleared the doubt to whoever asked this. Vishal, am I clear
other
my
questions,
doubt?
Please.
Share your GitHub profile. Okay, share my GitHub profile. Yeah, again, this was my GitHub link. You could go and access my GitHub to see my codes. Okay. And are there any other questions left for me?
Yeah, I think there were some. What about regularization in sigmoid?
Regularization in sigmoid, I have not applied the regularizations yet because you don't need to apply in simple machine learning. Now, when it applies in deep learning, I could take another seminar. I could show those points in another seminar. That would be much better to do. But for now, in normal logistic regression, which I have tried to address in this session, I don't think you would need regularization for logistic regression. Initializing it with a random value would be good enough to meet your expectations for comparison with logistic.
Okay. Another is MSE used for classification? If not, why? Also, is it right to use?
I think I just told that, but anyway, let me repeat over that. So mean squared error will not be good for classification because it will do its loss reduction very slowly. Even though the points which have some error, it will diminish the points. So if you can see in this case, these points which are not fully classified, the loss from these will be further diminished and the learning will be slow. It's not that you can't use it, you can use it. But the point that it will be very slow in learning these points. It will not be at a good pace. So you'll take 10,000 EPOs maybe to even learn a simple classification model. Whereas if you use it for, if you use cross entropy for classification, it will be much faster.
So some people are saying it was really well explained. Some were of a different opinion, but that's fine, I think. And
Thank you for the feedback.
So everybody is asking for GitHub oblique your notebook. So I guess you will be sharing it. You have already shared it, and also I suggest you can post it on the video link that we'll be sharing in a few days.
Okay, sure. I'll share it with you, Vishal. That's not an issue. This is my GitHub. So anyone wants to access it, you can go and check it out on my GitHub.
Great. So thank you all for attending, and thanks, Yash.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
So, okay, great. Thanks a lot. Thank you, and good night to
yeah,
all.
Yeah, I would like to thank everyone for attending the webinar.
Sure. Good night.